What does it mean to be equal? Health officials this week confirmed that ethnicity is now one of many factors being considered as part of an algorithm to prioritise surgeries. But instead of just focusing on the is it racist debate, this week on Q&A, given the focus on equality, we wanted to take a closer look at one of the key ways we map deprivation and population trends so that we can actually understand the makeup of and disparities between our different communities. The census. The last census in 2018 was a debacle. The former boss of Statistics New Zealand resigned after an independent review, found it was overly complex and ineffective, with unacceptably low response rates, particularly in Māori and Pasifika communities. It's now 3.5 months since this year's census day, but despite changing the strategy, investing in community outreach and lowering the overall response targets, the latest data shows more than 500,000 people still haven't completed their individual census declarations. Now, a quick note, these numbers we're going to share with you are raw figures, so they're based on the number of people that have returned to form. They're not the final official figures. But at this stage of the process, it's the best information we can access. The census officially closes in 5 days, and this is how the numbers are shaping up. At a regional level, all of the South Island has hit the government's 90% target for responses. But it's a different story in the North Island. No district has hit 90% as of Thursday afternoon. Northland and Hawke's Bay have the lowest turnouts by region. Of course, Hawke's Bay hit by Cyclone Gabrielle. But look at this, if you zoom in on Auckland, you can see South Auckland has some of the lowest rates for census completion. So what about ethnicity data? Well, Māori and Pasifika advocates have warned there still wasn't enough community involvement this year. So let's have a look at the numbers. For Māori across New Zealand, 1 in 4 have yet to return their individual census forms. For Pasifika communities, the response rate is only marginally better, 79%. Going from these numbers, the government has improved on the numbers from the 2018 census, but it still needs 60,000 individuals to fill in their forms this week in order to hit the target. Now, shortly, we're going to speak to the minister responsible, but first, reporter Ira Lee looks at the home straight push.
Come for the kai. Stay for the census.
Like, if it wasn't for Marito and Morai coming out to bring out, you know, the hangis, the coffee, the donuts, bouncy castles at the parks, you know, I don't think a lot of us would actually come out of our houses.
The big push to get people to do their census has finished, but Stats New Zealand has asked Manurewa Marae, alongside other whānau order providers, to target those hardest to reach.
I remember opening up the envelope and just seeing all these papers and I was like, no!
The only thing that's really stopped me from filling in the census is just fear.
We know that our census number out here in South Auckland are very low. Throughout COVID, we ran events exactly like this and it brought our families and community out and they got vaccinations done.
After a low turnout in the botched 2018 census, Te Whatu Ora says Counties Monaco lost $130 million in health funding. It's something Pacific Health provider South Seas knows all too well.
We want all the resources to come to these sort of communities. One of the things that we have to do better is actually explain the importance of filling out the forms.
In Monaco, people who completed their census earned points to put towards fundraising for schools and churches, with money coming from local businesses, as well as getting 3,000 people to fill out the census. Just under 500 got vaccinated.
There's a trust issue with our people. You don't know where your information is going. We don't know what they're saying is true. So our experience as a community sort of provider is that, you know, you can't also focus on that particular thing. For example, the census, it has to be a whole family community event.
But the approach has raised eyebrows among opposition MPs.
Does the minister believe that it's fair that people who completed their census on time got no rewards, while those who didn't complete their census on time received rewards for doing so?
The costs for the census have swelled from the $210 million announced 3 years ago to close to $320 million. Some of that money went into extra advertising, more staff and efforts in cyclone-hit areas. At least $175,000 was spent on supermarket and petrol vouchers for thousands of people across the country. But organisations say the costs can be minimal if efforts are tailored to each community from the start.
Yep, there is money behind this, but the bigger picture is actually seeing our families come outside here.
In a few hours, Manurewa Marae collected dozens of forms in Randwick Park.
Whānau, when you do go into their space, especially their living spaces, you know, it's intrusive to them. They would have got so many knocks on the doors for people to, you know, for them to fill their forms out. So let's not continue to do that, and let's do events like this.
There was no barriers once we started engaging with State New Zealand. They could have come and said, no, this is how we want to do it. But based on our experience, we actually said, look, this is what you have to do. I mean, 3,000 in 3 days, it's not a bad record. Imagine what we could have done a bit longer.
It's Q&A reporter Ira Lee reporting there. So, in charge of this year's census is the Minister for Statistics, Deborah Russell. Kia ora, good morning. Welcome to Q&A.
Morena.
With 5 days to go, will the government hit its nationwide 90% target?
Well, first of all, I actually want to thank everyone who has completed the census. That data is really important for us. Yes, there are 5 days to go. We're sitting at about 89%, as you reported, for the country overall. Whether we get to that 90%, we'll see. We've actually had 92% of households return form, so we're a little bit over there. And in terms of getting a final count, we're not going to know that accurately until we've done the post-enumeration survey, a bit of a survey work later on this year. We really can't report on that until sometime next year.
Okay, to be clear though, you need 60,000 people to return individual forms by the end of this week in order to hit that 90% target. Given the trajectory at the moment, do you think it's likely the government will hit the 90% target?
Well, that's just the raw rate,
yeah.
And there's a whole lot of other ways that government can make up that data, and which we're planning to do in any case. Whether or not we get to the 90%, a little bit of a moot point at the moment, but
I mean, you're the minister, so what's your take?
Oh, well, of course we're still aiming for that 90%.
Of course you're still aiming for it, but are you going to hit it?
We'll have to wait and see. There's a few days yet to go on that. And in terms of hitting it, that is very much a raw rate. It is not the actual coverage rate, and the coverage rate is the one that matters.
Yeah, I'm going to ask one more time and then we'll move on. You've said we'll see a couple of times here. What is your expectation as the minister who's closely following these numbers as they come in? Are we going to hit that target?
I have been watching the numbers very, very carefully every day. At this stage, it's looking like 89-90% for the raw rate, but it's the completion rate, the coverage rate that actually matters.
Right. Does that mean no?
It means we're still waiting for the last few days. We're not there yet. I'm sitting in there and thinking it's going to be 89-90%. We've got a few days to go.
Why is it such a close call?
Oh, you're right that it's a close call. We had hoped that we'd have gotten over that 90% before now, and that's what we were really aiming for. It is a close call because a couple of reasons. One, of course, Cyclone Gabriel blew right through the census collection, and that has made a difference. But the other thing is something that you've pointed to in your lead-in to this item, which is we've had lower response rates than we really wanted from our Māori communities and our Pacifica communities.
Why?
Well, in terms of thinking about why we've had those lower rates, there will be a whole lot of reasons. When we've talked to people from our Pacifica communities, it's been things like people not understanding the census or perhaps needing someone with them to do it with them in person. So we've needed to do a whole lot of community outreach. We've done that, but maybe we could have done more.
Okay, well, explain to me, you think you could have done more? What else could you have done?
Well, in terms of doing more, given that we haven't got the response rate we needed in those communities, in the Pacifica communities, and you, as you reported yourself, it was about 79%, then obviously we needed to do more. It's just a straightforward evaluation of what's actually happened. In terms of what more we could have done, it's easy to be wise in hindsight. Perhaps we could have done more visiting churches earlier on and so on, but that'll have to be one of the things we evaluate as we go into the evaluation phase of the census.
Yeah, Māori at 75%, even lower than Pacifica communities. Why is that so low?
Again, it's a little hard to know exactly why it's not hitting the target we wanted. There was a lot of work went into working with Māori this year in order to get a good census return rate. We've been working directly with iwi in some areas. We've tried outreach through marae. We've had Māori involved in the design of the census right from the start. In terms of why individual Māori have not felt able to engage with the census, it's hard to know exactly why. We'll certainly try to find out. It is in line with declining participation in surveys and censuses worldwide, but even so, it's lower than we would have liked to have had.
Are you willing to stake your job on hitting the 90% target? Absolutely. That was a question and answer you delivered in Parliament just a couple of months ago. Will you stand down if the national number doesn't meet the 90% mark?
On the day of the census, the last thing I was going to do was to undermine the census. So when a reporter asked me that question, I had to quickly think, am I going to undermine the census? No, I'm not.
How would that have undermined the census?
The last thing you want is a minister not expressing confidence in a huge activity that is taking place that day. I still remain confident that we're doing everything we can to get a good response rate.
So will you stand down?
As I said, I think I was expressing every confidence I could in the census in order not to undermine it on the day of the census itself.
So will you stand down?
I'm not going to answer that question, Jack.
Why not?
Especially when we haven't actually got the final...
You were trying to express confidence in the process of statistics in New Zealand. You're the minister responsible. Are you willing to stake your job on hitting that 90% target?
I'm still confident that we're going to get a really good coverage rate from the census.
Sorry, are you willing to stake your job on hitting that 90% target?
Well, we don't know where that 90% target is.
No, I'm aware of that. So
and
are you willing
I'm
to
not
stake
going to
your
stake
job?
My job on a number that we don't know yet.
So what's changed between now and census day? Just lower returns than you'd hoped?
In terms of what might have changed between now, 2 months, 3 months on from the actual census
I mean, if
day,
you said on census day that you were prepared to stake your job and hang the target, and today you're no longer prepared to stake your job
on the day of the
target.
Census, I was expressing real confidence in the whole process. I wanted to make sure I didn't undermine the census.
And so what are you expressing now?
I'm expressing confidence in the coverage rate we're going to get overall, which we think is going to be something around about 97-98%.
But not in the overall returns rate, which is what we're talking about here.
The overall return rate is a very, very raw number. It's a tally rate. And in terms of talking of the response rate to the census...
You can't honestly say to us that you're going to answer that question as clearly and effusively as you did on that day, but not answer it the same way today. Or at least give us an explanation why you've completely changed positions.
I have to say, it's the first time I've heard one word being described as an effusive answer. But what I was doing on the day of the census was ensuring... it was an answer that was expressing confidence in the census processes that day.
But does that mean that you are no longer doing that?
I'm not prepared to... bet something on a result that we don't have yet and on a tally
that we
don't
have. But you were on census day.
And we also need to distinguish between something that's the raw tally rate and the raw return rate, the raw rate that will come in later, and then what we actually get in terms of getting a really good data set. And I'm confident we're going to get a really good data set from the census.
10 years ago, the 2013 census, we had a similar turnout nationwide. So it's slightly higher, and I appreciate we're still waiting on those final numbers, but a much, much higher rate in terms of the Māori population. So 88.3% of Māori filled out their original forms. What do you think has changed in that decade?
So the last really robust census we had was back in 2013, as you say. There's a whole lot of stuff that has changed in the intervening 10 years. Worldwide, there's a phenomenon of declining responses to surveys and declining responses to censuses. So we're not the only statistics bureau that's caught up in that. And in particularly in the last few years, we have, through the rise of misinformation and disinformation, seen declining trust in governments. So I think it's part of that phenomenon.
Off the back of the review in 2018, you were warned about outreach with Māori and Pacifica communities in particular, weren't you? So do you take responsibility for those low return rates this year?
So in terms of the low return rates from Pacifica and Māori communities, we have done a lot of work to try to connect with those communities.
I know, but we're still looking at 75 and 79% as the numbers stand at the moment. So clearly those aren't good enough.
I think those numbers can give us a basis to get a really good head count.
Are those numbers acceptable?
We'd like them to be higher. But
are those numbers acceptable?
Well, the way we can get to an acceptable overall rate is to use administrative data to backfill. So this is what was done in 2018. We've got a better result this time, and we are able to go to other data sources to make sure that we've at least got a good population count.
And unlike 2018, you've actually designed your census model this year around using those other sources of data. But to be clear, is a 75% response rate from Māori communities acceptable as far as you're concerned?
In terms of that response rate, it's a really disappointing rate. We did try to engage with Māori communities and to design the whole census with Māori. Clearly, we've got to do more work there to see if we can get a better result
Do you as Minister take responsibility for those numbers not being higher?
I would certainly like to see them higher. Obviously, I'm going to have to go back to statistics and say, come on, guys, what do we do better next time?
Do you take responsibility? How can we make this better?
Certainly the statistics, Statistics New Zealand and us, we do need to sort of think what we could do better next time around.
The overall cost this year was $317 million, so about $107 million more than 5 years ago. In terms of results, it's looking like we'll end up with a 6% higher response rate. So every 1% costs about $18 million. What have we got for that additional spend in terms of the quality of data?
It has cost a lot more this time around. Partly that's because last time around with a lower spend, we got to around about 80% of the population. But it's always harder to get the next 10% and then the next 5% and then it's very hard to get to those last few. So it does cost more to get each bit of
echelon.
Chunk. Echelon's a nice word, yeah. In terms of that, we have overall gotten an overall response rate that is good enough by the time we combine it with administrative data to get to about a 97-98% coverage rate. So it does give us a good enough population count to go forward from here. So we will have a good data set for a whole lot of the stuff we do as a government.
Why is it fair that some people get paid for doing their census late?
You're referring to the place where we started using incentives to encourage people
Warriors
to complete
tickets,
the census.
Supermarket and petrol vouchers. Do you think it's fair that people who've left their census are given Warriors tickets or supermarket vouchers for doing it late?
Our objective in doing the census is to get the best population count we can. And the great majority of us just do the census, so fill it out. It's just part of what we do because we're New Zealanders, we participate in it.
And but so is it fair that people who don't do that are given Warriors tickets and supermarket vouchers?
What was decided was around about April 11, the Census Board met and said it was time to start rolling out incentives. So there was always a plan in place to use just the ordinary processes
Sorry to pick on this question. Is it fair?
What we need is a good data set. We need to achieve it by whatever means we can. And what we needed to do was to deploy a whole lot of different methods to reach into our hard-to-reach communities.
I haven't answered that question. Is it fair?
Most of us don't need an incentive to do the census.
Most of us do it just because it's our civic duty. But is it fair?
It's not a payment in terms of completing a job. What it was to encourage communities to come in. If we look at the Warriors promotion, I think 1,985 people got tickets to the Warriors. But in terms of that promotion, there was a whole promotion associated with it and a whole advertising reach that went to about 500,000 people.
You're just giving me examples of the incentives, but you haven't asked, is it fair, which is the question I've asked 73 times.
I'm not sure. We needed a really good data set, and the way to get that, we had to deploy a whole lot of methods to achieve it. Right now, too, we're actually going to the stage of sending out notices to people saying, actually, if you don't complete, you are liable for prosecution.
Is it your expectation that people will be prosecuted?
In terms of prosecuting people for the census, Statistics New Zealand does that. Obviously, you don't want ministers deciding whether or not individuals get prosecuted.
But is it your expectation, given the 60,000 people haven't filled in their forms, that some of those people will face prosecution?
I've talked to Statistics New Zealand about that, and they've told me that in terms of prosecuting, they look for the people in terms of prosecuting. It's not just not doing the census. It's people who've actively discouraged others from doing the census or have refused in a particularly aggressive way to do it.
Right.
Or people who have acted as barriers to other people doing it. Say like a boarding house manager who won't distribute forms to people in the boarding house and so on.
At how many events are you aware of in which Statistics New Zealand staff have held events and incentivised gang members to fill in their census forms. Mm, mm.
So in terms of those hard-to-reach communities, one of the things we did eventually was to work with a whole lot of community groups. Mm. In terms of the number of events where we were hoping to count gang members, because everyone counts, I think there was half a dozen.
Right. Mm. After the last census, the government ordered an independent review. From what we understand about this census, will you be doing the same?
Oh, of course.
You will be.
In terms of an independent review, yeah. I'm not sure about independent yet. That would be a decision we need to make. But there will, of course, be a post-census evaluation yeah. and a whole lot of thinking going into whether or not we should engage in this whole exercise again mm. or how we do it again in the future. Mm.
Very quickly, tax policy is playing a significant role in this election, which I'm sure is a great source of excitement for you. As Associate Revenue Minister and a tax expert of sorts, what role are you playing in helping to develop Labor's tax policy?
Oh, well, Labor's tax policy will be released before the election. Mm-hmm. And I do sit on our policy council, so I am involved in some of that. However, our tax policy comes from our party, not from ministers.
Mm, but of course, you'll be informing some of the decisions, I'm sure, and having a role in shaping it. Mm. I went and had a quick flick through your book again, Tax and Fairness, yeah. Which is the book you published on tax. And that page 133 quote I had to put to you, quote, "We should smile when we pay our taxes." Do you still believe that?
Yes, I do. Yes, I do. I just want to acknowledge my co-author, Terry Boucher, here. Mm. Yes, our taxes contribute to all the things we like having as a nation, like our roads and our health system and our education system. If we want to live in a decent society, we need to pay for it.
What did you make of the Greens tax policy? Mm.
I thought the Greens tax policy was very interesting. One of the things that puzzled me is they didn't seem to allow for behavioural responses, so I would need to dig into it a little more to have a really good view on it.
It's time to get serious about fixing one of the biggest remaining inequities in our tax system. That's from you again. That's a quote from you. In your observation, has anything changed in terms of public sentiment towards a comprehensive capital gains tax?
In terms of public sentiment towards a comprehensive capital gains tax, a lot of people say that they support it on paper. On the other hand, we have tried three times as a Labor Party to put forward a comprehensive capital gains tax, and each time we've been unable to get it across the line. So I think it's one of those things where people often say, yes, they support it, but they're not quite so certain about it when they realise it might affect them personally.
Right. Do you think that has shifted at all since the previous times the party considered a CGT?
I do think we have had somewhat of a shift in sentiment around capital gains taxes. Whether it is enough to then support it in reality is a different matter.
Mm. Have you heard any more from Meng Foon this week?
I haven't spoken to Meng Foon personally since I was first given the delegation to look into his conflicts of interest. So I've been very careful not to speak to him in person because obviously that could conflict the process. But I wish him well.
Thank you very much for your time. Minister for Statistics, Deborah Russell, kia ora.
Thank you.